Good afternoon, everyone. So, I'll talk about the component of our project, which is climate change vulnerability mapping of selected municipalities in the Mainland Philippines. So this is just a component of the entire project entitled, as was mentioned earlier, well, building capacity to adapt to climate change in Southeast Asia. So this is a three-year project. Three countries are involved: Philippines, Vietnam, and Cambodia. And for every country, it has three components: the mapping component, the social component, which is led by Prof. here, and economic part component, which is led by Prof. Ayas. Again, I am Assistant Professor Vicente Valero Jr. from the College of Engineering, UPMB. And again, good afternoon. So, to start with, first, show you some of the negative impacts of extreme climate events. Of course, it could kill people, devastate means of livelihood, wreck houses, buildings, and other structures, and even destroy natural resources and biodiversity, and a lot more. And all of this, the negative impacts of extreme climate events, translate to huge economic losses that can be detrimental to further improvements of food security. So comes this project, right? And the overall objective of our project, by the way, this is a circa implemented project and funded by the IDRC of Canada. So the overall objective is to build local capacities to adapt to climate change, especially in the area of vulnerability assessment and adaptation analysis. And specifically, on my part, my component, the specific objectives are to measure the community's or the barangay's vulnerability to climate-related hazards and to produce maps on the relative vulnerability of communities. And this maps will be shown as we go along. First, from our country, we focused our study site here in the Laguna province. You'll notice the study site comprised of three watersheds here. The left watershed here is the Babacan. The middle watershed here is the Santa Cruz, and this one is Malanac. Okay. Maybe you're wondering why not the entire province of Laguna. Okay. Anyway, for Cambodia, they chose the Kampong Spu province. Okay. It only has 87 communes or barangay. Okay. So, show this. The entire province of Laguna consists of 13 municipalities and all in all 676 barangays. Where in Cambodia, it has the Kampong Spu, it has around 87 communes. They call their barangays communes in Cambodia and Vietnam. So, when I say communes or barangays, I refer to the exact same thing, okay? The smallest unit of government. So, because of this, the problem with the Philippines is a large number of barangays because the size of our barangays are quite smaller compared to the size of the communes of Vietnam and Cambodia. So, from Cambodia, it's 87. Vietnam, their study site is Tua Thien Quy, which has 152 communes. So compare this to 76, and of course the funding is equally divided, if I'm not mistaken, to the three countries. So the fund will not be enough to sustain this entire province of Laguna. Hence, we bring it down to from 30 down to 12 municipalities. From 676 barangays down to 274 barangays. This is still a lot compared to 152 of Vietnam. So we again are really down using the stratified random sampling. So down to 194 barangays. So to give you the entire province of Laguna is about 1,800 square kilometers in area, where the study site is down to about 600 square kilometers. And to compare the population using the 2007 census data, from about 2.5 million, it's bringing up to the 23% of it, so about 600,000. Okay. So how did we come up with these 12 municipalities or these three sites? These That is, here we use the watershed approach. We use this such that, of course, flooding occurs at the low level because of watershed is on level, but one of the contributors of floods are coming from the highlands. So we use watershed approach to represent the highlands, the midlands, the lowlands, and of course the midlands. And the proposed watershed includes the municipalities that have experienced flooding and heavy typhoon damages in recent years. And the chosen watershed includes also the agricultural area of Laguna. Of course, one of the Laguna Lake is the largest living lake in Southeast Asia. It's about 90,000 hectares. And this serves as a catchment basin for 21 major tributaries with a total catchment area of about 45,000 square kilometers. And out of these 21 major tributaries, 17 of them drain into the lake are within Laguna. So 17 out of 21. And it has only a single outlet through Manila Bay through the Pintan Channel. Okay. So it comes to methodology. So this is a 3-year project. So the first year involves our team, which is the mapping part. So first, we identify the vulnerability to permanence and their indicators. Okay? So we use 3 determinants here, the exposure or the hazard, sensitivity, and adaptive capacity. So this is, these 3 determinants are based on the past studies of Yusuf and Francisco, also with vulnerability mapping. So I'll go to them one by one. First is the exposure determinant. This. Okay. So out of this determinant, we focus on 2 indicators, which is the typhoon and flood. Cambodia, they add drought because drought really affects their country. While in Vietnam, they add extreme cold. Okay. For the Philippines, it's only the typhoon and flood. And when we say exposure or hazard, this is essentially the nature and extent by which a particular community experiences climate hazards such as typhoons, floods, and droughts. To give you a brief overview of the indicators under hazard, so under hazard determinant, we have 2 indicators, typhoon and flood, and they have sub-indicators. For example, for typhoon, the number of typhoons for the last 10 years, how many are above signal number 2, for the flooding, how many flooding events experienced in each barangay, the average flood level and the number of days we are affected. So the next determinant is the sensitivity. And when we say sensitivity, okay, focus on 4 indicators: natural sensitivity, human sensitivity, infrastructure, and the livelihood sensitivity. Okay. And to define what we mean by sensitivity, this is the degree by which the community is affected by climate change stressors. And to give the background of our database here. So for sensitivity, these are the indicators: natural, human, infra, etc. And under natural sensitivity, there are some indicators. I won't cover them one by one, so at the same time. Okay, and the last determinant is the adaptive capacity. So it has 5 indicators in terms of infrastructure, economic, technology, social, and human adaptive capacity. We define adaptive capacity as this one: as reflects the ability of the community to adjust its practices and behavior so that the impacts of climate change area are reduced. Sample database or the adaptive capacity here. Okay. For example, and let's go to the technology. Example, under technology indicator, there are some indicators meaning how many percentage the barangay has loudspeaker, radio, home TV, etc. After identifying, by the way, these 3 determinants are in consensus with the other 2 countries, Vietnam and Cambodia. So after identifying this, the tedious part in our first year project, the first year of the project is the data collection. So after collecting data, completing the indicators and sub-indicators. We assessed it, okay? The three determinants, and using software and GIS skills, we came up with a vulnerability index maps, which I will show you later on. And by the way, this entire methodology, of course, has the participation from local officials, communities, and other stakeholders. In fact, in terms of giving weights to these indicators, we did a focus group discussion and came for the interviews to come up with the weights, and I used the analytic hierarchy process to give weights to the indicators. And we are guided by this framework, also used by Yusuf and Francisco. Vulnerability is just the function of the three determinants I mentioned, so exposure, sensitivities, and adaptive capacity. Function of these three will result to the overall vulnerability. We give a closer look at the start site. So, 12 municipalities involves Los Baños, Bay, Calawan, Rizal, Nagarlan, Victoria, Tila, Liliu, Mayhay, Magdalena, Santa Cruz, etc. 12 of them. To show you the political boundaries, of course, the red lines are the three watersheds, and the dark blue lines are the municipal boundaries, and the thin lines, which are composed of small polygons, are the primary boundaries. To show you the watershed approach, to show you that indeed the topography from highlands, midlands, lowlands to coastal regions are represented by the watershed approach. So this is the digital elevation model of the image of the study site. And superimposing there the boundaries just like this. Okay. And the map, okay. So I came up with this. From 0 to 1, meaning least vulnerable to most vulnerable. So, that is the color from yellow, turning orange, and then turning red. Okay? If you see more red in the map, meaning say they are highly vulnerable regions. So, to begin with, exposure determinants. So, this is the resulting map, the relative vulnerability map in terms of exposure. You notice more on yellow. Red and orange portion in the coastal areas. Some orange portion in the highlands because of the flash flooding that occurs there. Of course, if the density of the rainfall is very high, the natural drainage cannot accommodate the entire rain, therefore causing flash flood. But it's just a matter of minutes. So this is the resulting exposure map. This is the tabular representation of that map. And I chose those 0.5 and above, exceeding 0.5 up to 1 in the vulnerability index. And you'll notice, look at the topographic classification. As expected, of course, the highly exposed in terms of topographic classification are the coastal and the lowland regions. These are having 0.5 and above vulnerability. In terms of sensitivity, you notice from yellow, it's now more red and orange. Meaning to say, Laguna province is highly sensitive when it comes to climate change. And okay, this is the tabular representation of that map. And I just emphasize, let's say the top four most vulnerable in terms of sensitivity. 0.776, 0.82, 0.916, 0.9, but all of them, the top four are coastal barangays. And last, the adaptive capacity. More red, more orange compared to sensitivity. So sad to say, Laguna, in terms of adapting to climate change, we have very low capacity to adapt. Hence, resulting in this. This is the tabular representation. So I count the number of, these are the 12 municipalities. The number of vulnerable barangays, for example, in Bay, 8 out of 40, resulting to 57%. So the three least vulnerable in terms of adaptive capacity, or having a high capacity to adapt, Victoria, Pagsanhan, and the one with the highest capacity of that particular things, Los Baños. And when I presented this to the LGUs involving this, the municipalities, they seem to agree with the result. And the top three most vulnerable in terms of adaptive capacity, Mayhay, 83%, Calawan, 88%, and Magdalena, 9 out of 10, Barangays, 90%. So these three, which red over here, is has low adaptive capacity. And overall, of course, overall is the function of the three determinants combining the three. Of course, the red and orange colors lessen because it compromised the exposure data. So this is the result in overall vulnerability. And this is a tabular representation. And of course, we also gathered, we also made a map for the agricultural sector. Of course, the indicators are somewhat different compared to the commune mapping. So in terms of agricultural sector, so the indicators there are agriculturally related questions. So in terms of exposure, this is the resulting map. More orange and red here compared to the exposure in terms of commune. Sensitivity, more red, more orange, and adaptive capacity, of course, more red, okay? And overall, this is the overall agricultural . This is the tabulated. And to summarize our result, so I have two columns here, the commune, which is the vulnerability commune mapping, and the agricultural sector. You'll notice, in terms of exposure, 5 out of 12 municipalities are exposed, comprising of 9 barangays. In agricultural sector, it increased from 5 to 11. 11 municipalities are highly vulnerable in terms of agricultural sector, comprising 27 barangays. So the most vulnerable barangay in terms of exposure, or the highly exposed barangay, is the San Pablo North of Santa Cruz. In terms of the agricultural sector, it's the Lagumin of Pina. While in terms of sensitivity, the entire study site, the 12 municipalities are highly sensitive, increasing from 9 to 59 barangays. And which is the most vulnerable is the Tubuan of Pila. In terms of its agricultural sector, under the sensitivity, 11 out of 12 municipalities, increasing from 27 involved in the exposure, sensitivity is increased to 66, and the most vulnerable barangay in terms of sensitivity in the agricultural sector is Bedan High of Victoria. Adaptive capacity, 12 out of 12, so all municipalities have low capacity to adapt. Dramatically increased from 59 to 135 barangays, and the most vulnerable barangay is the Ilayan at Ingay of Magdalena. Where in the agricultural sector, again 12 out of 12, 98 barangays, and the most vulnerable is the Talaga of Rizal. In joining the three determinants, we have the overall. So overall, it's just 11 out of 12, involving 37 barangays, and the most vulnerable overall barangay is the San Pablo Norte of Santa Cruz, which is in coastal area. In terms of the agricultural sector, 12 out of 12 are vulnerable overall, 48 barangays involved, and the Laguin of Pila is the most vulnerable barangay in terms of agricultural sector overall. So, this is the result of our study, the mapping part. And we did this during the year 2011, and by the month of November, I am already analyzing my result, and I share guys requiring me to give them the write-up, okay? And as I am contemplating in my result, although Laguna is not that highly exposed, of course, we know that, the Philippines, which part of the Philippines are highly exposed to typhoons? The northern portion of the Philippines and the Bicol region, right? It's not the Laguna province now. So that's why we're not that highly exposed. But what is alarming here is the high sensitivity and very low adaptive capacity of the Laguna province. So my conclusion during my write-up is, what if there's a climate change, which is inevitable. So what will happen to your life? Out of 21, in a year, average typhoon in a year is around 90 to 21. What if most of the typhoons, the trucks be going to Laguna? So we're very much in here. And that's what it was. My theory is strengthened by the Typhoon Chaetong. Wherein Chaetong's truck is here. It's the today and the other one's here, right? So that was December 2011. Were they warned by Pagasa? Yes. Pagasa said that the Typhoon truck of Chaetong is towards here. But did they said, oh, it's just 100 years, it just passed through here, in the area. They're not that prepared, so what happened? It caused a lot of death, millions of properties, and this. Because they are not highly exposed. Because, of course, Mindanao areas are not exposed to typhoons compared to the Luzon side. But then what happened? Loss of lives, millions of damages to properties. So, not that highly exposed, but they have also low capacity to adapt. Very sensitive. I'm giving it to the Oro. 5 years ago, I went there to do water rafting. So I noticed that even in the water bodies, they have communities there. So, and when I watched the news, the water level in the Cagayan Oro, even nilagpasan yung bridge where the water raft came. So, I expect some of the communities there were wiped out. So it's because they are highly sensitive and they have low uptake capacity. So that's alarming. Another thing here is, for example, in terms of Japan. Remember the earthquake, the tsunami in Japan? That was year 2011. The exposure to earthquake is very high because they belong to the Pacific Ring of Fire, right? But they have high adaptive capacity. Why? Because there are structures there, no? Yung mga buildings nila, may gulong yun. No? So therefore, kung may earthquake, it will just move. No? Unlike sa Pilipinas. No? Kung nakafix yan, then there's earthquake, of course, expect na massive yung damage. Compare it to what happened to Haiti previous, mas nauna pa, before the Japan earthquake. The earthquake in Haiti. Saan mas maraming damages? In terms of lives. Of course, may tsunami pa kasi in Japan eh. But earthquake alam ka, mas maraming damages sa Haiti. So what am I trying to point out here? Haiti is a third world country. Right? So, in terms of adaptive capacity, sensitivity there, very high sensitivity, low adaptive capacity, therefore resulting to more damages. And what is alarming here is Philippines. Why? Philippines is a third world country, and we also belong to the Pacific Ring of Fire. Okay, so yun yung ano, kakatawa, okay? So, going back here, so they said, oh, it's just one in 100 year event. I've heard the news, no? Yun yung reaction ng mga tao. Then, what happened the following year? Same month, December 2012. Sorry for the image, but Typhoon Pablo also went here. Hitting Sabuanga. Right? So, one in 100 year event. Can one in 100 year event happen back-to-back year? Is it possible? One in 100 year event happen back-to-back? Yes. As long as the next 99 years, there will be no typhoon hitting the Mindanao area. That is still one in 100 events. But I doubt, the next 99 years, no typhoon will hit the Mindanao. So I guess climate change is around. Especially in the coming 4 months, the polarity of sun is reversing, right? As reported by NASA. So expect stormy weather now in the tropics, okay? So, show you some damages from Typhoon Chaetong, the flash flood, damages to properties, And last year, December 2012, I'm in Fablo. And I don't know, this December 2013. Okay. So, this is important, this is the new year. So, you must go ahead with this one. So, I guess, our project can help in terms of project proposal and adaptation options improve, so that's what lessen damages and especially in the loss of lives. So that's my presentation and thank you for listening.
Loudspeakers, number of loudspeakers, radio, TV. How do you factor in the possibility that this equipment may not prove to be useful if there's a brownout? I mean, because we're talking of adaptive capacity. So, what if, regardless of the number of this equipment, this may not prove to be useful during calamities?
Actually, we took note of that. When we asked that question, we asked it first if it's functional, whether there's calamity, if it's functioning. So if it's not functioning, we do not count it. And most of the loudspeaker they have is built in their vehicle. So regardless of
if there's a
brownout, it will function.
So my next question is, with these results, were there any, what I want to find out is the name in this component and two other components. So, were the results of the first component used for the second and third components and how? So, it's either engineer or Ma'am Emmy.
Ma'am Emmy. Yes, it was used by Ma'am Emmy for the
last discipline. Actually, as a three-country study, there are two broad strokes from a research point of view. The first year we did the vulnerability assessment. And so when Sir Enteng mentioned that he took care of the mapping component, that is just part of the whole vulnerability assessment study. And yes, there was a need because what Sir Enteng did was to look into the community vulnerability. The economic expert in the team, that's Prof. Kim of SEM, Kim Arias, took care of the household vulnerability for the same study area. Yours truly was assigned to ensure that social and gender considerations are included. And so if you notice, hindi na masyado tinatch ni Sir Enteng kasi mahaba masyado, but we'll be doing a little of that next week. No? What we wanted to point out also is that most of the indicators for sensitivity and adaptive capacity that really mattered were social and human in nature rather than biophysical. We're not discounting the biophysical and technological indicators, but what we're saying is that based on our findings, much can be said regarding the contribution of the social and humanity workers.
So if you're interested in how this data was used, so next week it will be presented by Mami.
Good afternoon, sir. I am Lorena Donas-Aquino, a graduate student under CESA, Environmental Science. My curious is about the adaptive capacity. Have you considered the adaptation mechanism of the local government units by increasing the adaptive capacities of the communities? Have you included that in their adaptive capacity, the adaptive mechanism of the LGUs?
Actually, that is the third year part of the project is to have some proposals how will the local government adapt to the LGUs.
Other questions?
Mario Mobillon, Chief Science Research Specialist, Field Rights. It's a comprehensive observation and clarification question. First, yung tatlong terminals you mentioned, are they directly correlated or some of them inversely correlated to one another to determine the overall border unity? And then among the three determinants, which among these three is the most crucial, was critical in terms of all the three determinants. And last is, I know it's coming still, your presentation next week, but in terms of project proposals for adaptation and mitigation, because we can see here some possible projection in terms of usage for adaptation and mitigation measures. So we are also climate change centers of field rights, and we're also asking our staff are asked to prepare proposals related to adaptation and mitigation. And so since you have laid out a three-year project, we feel that it's a very good source of information and referencing for us in terms of future proposals related to mitigation and adaptation.
So your first question about I think you're referring to the weights. So the three determinants, we decided to have it equal weights, 0.33 each. And in terms of directly correlate the relationship, the exposure and sensitivity are directly related. Well, the inverse is the adaptive capacity. So that's why, meaning to say, the higher your capacity to adapt, the lower will be the average. And in terms of the, actually, we conducted project dissemination and our project proposal writing last June. And there are already some LGUs are writing their proposal and using our data as their source, as their to back up their proposal.
Your study is very interesting. I am Dr. Florencio Mauricio Forrester, a former researcher at ERDB and assistant professor and professor lecturer at the College of Forestry. My question is, I don't know if you explained this, but if you did, please explain further. Does the location and direction of the location of the municipality or the barangay from the lake Laguna de Bay and from Mount Makiling has something to do with the adaptability, with the vulnerability, the adaptability of these municipalities and barangays
it was considered in terms of the geographical location. For example, in the sensitivity, there are some indicators here. For example, under natural sensitivity. So, part of the sub-indicators are how many percentage are forest area, how many are protected, the percentage of steep slope, how many are low-lying area. So, with the difference in the topography, it is accounted. So, it has its own weight, by the way, it has its own index. In terms of the typhoon and flood, we have data to support which barangay is affected in terms of which barangay is hit by above signal number 2, how many for the last 10 years, how many flooding events they experience, what's the average flood level that the barangay experience, and how long the flood lasted. So those are taken into account. So in coming up with a vulnerability indices. I hope you I answered your question.
So,
another is, we know that the lower the area or the lower the area of the place,
yes,
the more vulnerable to floods.
Yes.
But again, the lower areas are farther from Mount Magiling. Yes. And since Mount Magiling is not forested, almost no more trees, so it should be that the municipalities or areas nearest or nearer to Mount Magiling should be flooded again, the areas farther or lower farther from Mount Magiling and lower in elevation should be more susceptible to sensitive to flooding. Is that right?
Yes, sir. That's why, look at, if you notice in our exposure map here, so there are portions, even in the Midlands, that has dark color here, meaning to say they also experience flooding, maybe because of the deforested area in the upper portion, and their natural drainage cannot compensate the incoming water due to heavy intensity. So it is accounted for. Because we asked all of the barangays from the indicator, so we know that if they are really affected by flooding, and their answer may reflect based on how, based on their topography, and kung talagang kalbo na yung kanilang forest mass.
Waiting to post a question. Good afternoon, sir. I'm Jesper Dennis, studying MS Wildlife. So, in terms of adaptive capacity, you presented the top 3 lowest ranking barangays. What about the top 10 highest ranking, the best of the best, kumbaga, in terms of adaptive capacity? And follow-up, out of the best of the best, what improvement should they still make in terms of adaptive?
I presented the top 3 and the least the bottom 3. So the one that has high capacity to adopt are Victoria, Pajanhan, and Los Palmas. And the top 3 which has very low adaptive capacity are the Maihai, Calawan, and Magdalena. So if you notice in our database, in terms of adaptive capacity, there is also, for example, a question in technology. So in terms of their internet connection, first, if you are more high tech, then you have higher capacity to adapt because you can easily forward the people around you. Something like that. So this is a combination of different indicators. So if they really wanna take into closer look, so I can show them the data where they, for example, for a particular municipality, they are interested why they have no adaptive capacity. So we can work it out. I can show to them where they lack and what are their weaknesses based on data that we gathered.
Okay. Sir, for Ms. Bias, since siya yung highest, what do we still need to do to increase our adaptive capacity? For Ms. Bias in particular.
For Ms. Bias in particular? I guess it has also something to do with the, of course, part of the adaptive capacity indicators here are the budget of development projects, so the income per capita, they also play a factor here. So, in terms of development projects, maybe because in terms of IRA, so it plays a lot in terms of the capacity to adapt. So, the more budget you have, the more projects you can implement to increase the adaptive capacity of a particular barangay. Our
thank you, sir. Other questions or queries?
Sir. Last question.
Yes, sir.
You mentioned this is the case of Laguna, and then you mentioned typhoon floods the last 2 years. So, common knowledge in the Philippines about the different kumakita ng weather data ng Pagasa the last 5 to 10 years, the typhoon floods are clearly spelled out, including the there's the comprehensive land use in the Philippines. Even looking at those data, can you say region-wise, we have Lamarigasan at 16. So many regions, I think in top 10 regions in terms of vulnerability and three regions that medyo, five regions that may higher capability to adapt, which is total, as I'm without looking, I'm sure you have browsed your your site than this, but common data says that some of these are, kasi ibinigay sa aming parang caution, if this is happening in Laguna, which is possibly the adaptive, better adaptive caution, what about the others, others in the Philippines? They're looking at the whole country.
Okay.
So, yung ibang parte ng Pilipinas, sir, hindi naman kasama dun sa study namin, but sir, and I did cite no, what happened in Mindanao. So, it's difficult to say which region would be more vulnerable within the country. Because we do lack a lot of vulnerability assessment. What Pag-asa data can show us, technically, will be exposure data. But given that there are a lot of other indicators that need to be considered to measure sensitivity and adaptive capacity, we're still lacking in a lot of information. I think this is the reason for the EcoTown framework being piloted by the Philippine Climate Change Commission, and part and parcel of that EcoTown framework is really starting with the vulnerability assessment. So we have a picture really of what's the quality of the vulnerability, and then we take it from there when it comes to planning for adaptation.